Hi everyone, this is Sagar Shah and I am here with a very interesting Endgame lecture. Well, I can see many of you guys feeling really bored. Oh my god, we are going to study the Endgame. Well, nothing is farther from truth that Endgame is boring, because what I'm going to show you now is exceedingly interesting. We are going to look at two positions from one of my favorite books and a favorite book of lot of players, Dvoretsky's Endgame Manual. I have it here with me. As you know, recently chessbaseindia has got these original books from the US, from Russell Publications. More about that later, but first, the position on your screen over here, it's black to play, and do you take the pawn on d7 or not? This is the question, and you need to make this decision, because once you take on d7, you go into the pawn endgame, and then you have to calculate everything very precisely. Okay, so you can pause the video and think about it. While you are doing it, I would like to just tell you that recently I was asked by someone that, you know, when you work on the end games, you are just moving away from your calculation, and is this a good idea? And I felt that it's not true, because when you work on such a position like this, as we will see now, you're calculating so much that actually pawn endgames help to improve your discipline of calculation. So we will be looking at it now, and perhaps for all those people who not only want to improve their endgame but also calculation should indulge in this. Now, rook into d7 is the best move in the position. You could be afraid that after rook d7, rook d7, king d7, white has this move f4, and that is why you want to begin with f4 here, because you see the pawn is falling. But here it's important to note that white can continue to press with rook c2, king d7 and rook c5, attacking the pawn on g5, and after rook g8 comes king e2, and here you can see that the king is going to come up from d3, e4, f5. This rook is cutting off the black king. It's going to be a very, very bad position for black. So it's now or never. You must take the pawn. Takes, takes. And here you have to be disciplined in your calculation and see that, okay, if king e3, f4 comes in, I go king e4, he plays king e6. I can't break through. If he goes king d4, if I go king d4, king d6 comes, and once again there is no way to break through. So here you realize that it's important for white, if he wants to play for a win, to begin with the move f4. And now black has two options. One is to take and the other one is to push. Now, taking looks logical, but once you delve deeper after king f3, king e6, king into f4 and king f6, here you have to spot this key move, which is g3. If you see this, you will be sure that, okay, I don't want to go here, because after takes takes, you see that white has been able to create an outside passer. So king g5, h4, king h5, and now king f4 comes in. You take the pawn, and in this race, white is way ahead. You know, he wins both the pawns and he's winning the game. So there we realize that g into f4 is out of question for black, and so g4 comes in. And now white, you know, taking the pawn makes no sense, because after hg, fg, these are very strong pawns for black. So you go for the move g3. I think this is what you should be thinking about, because if black gets to play g3 here, then white has no way to play for a win. g3, and now black again has two options, hg3 and gh3. Okay, so what do you do now? Again, a tough question, because the most natural move seems hg3 takes gh3, and you come to this position which has to be assessed. But if you look at it carefully, you will realize that white is winning, because his king is entering from h5, and once the king comes here, this pawn is going to fall. So after king h4, king f6, king h5 is coming, and if you go the other way, king d5, king g5 is a mistake, of course, because of king e4, and you have these mind squares here. White is losing now, but king h5 is the correct move, because now if black jumps on the mind square, then white comes to g5 and game over. And if you play king d4, I'm the first one to attack the pawn with king g6. And after king e4, king g5, white is winning. So that's how we realize that this variation with hg3 and gh3 is not working at all. And hence, we have to begin with g into h3. This looks completely wrong, because after gh4, king e6, king g3, you're simply winning the pawn. King f6. And now white has two options. One, he can take the pawn. The other one is to play h5 to stop king g6. And I think h5 is the stronger move, because if you take king h3, then after king g6, there's simply no way to make progress. And white, if he tries to run away from this end over here, it won't really work, because after king h5, black is just too quick. Black is the one who may win the game. So here, it's important that white tries with h5, but black is smart. He plays king g7, and after king h3, now the final move to get the half point, what do you do? I hope you didn't rush in with king h6, because after king h4, white is winning. He gets the entry to g5. You play king h7, you wait so that if white comes to h4, you can come to h6 and block white. King g3, king g7, and you just keep, both sides will keep waiting. But if white decides to go the other way, once again, he's very slow and black wins the game. So guys, this was very important to note. I think the correct variation to end this entire analysis is after king h7, king g3, king g7, king h3, king h7, and the players agree to a draw. So we began with rook into d7, and that is the correct move for black, and that's how he can secure the draw. Okay, let's go to another position, shall we? I hope you're not too tired and you're enjoying yourself. That's what Endgames is all about. Here's the second position that we want to give you. There has been one move which has been made, which I need to correct here. Yeah, this is the position. So the question is, should black play rook h2, which was on the board, or should he play rook g4 here? Now, this is the question that I want to ask you, and it's not an easy question, because, okay, if you want to play rook h2, you can do so immediately. You are active with the rook, and but black, white has some defensive chances. But if you want to play rook g4, you have to calculate the entire pawn endgame, and this is important. Okay, so let's start with rook g4. Now, if white were to take rook into a6, then after rook h4, this is just winning for black. He has these powerful pawns here, and he's completely better. But after rook g4, hg4, the question arises as to, is black really winning here? Okay, king f2 looks normal. You want to come to g3. What do you play now with black? So two moves I'm sure you have considered. One is king f6, other is g5. If you didn't consider g5, then please make sure you look at candidate moves. This is because this is the first and foremost thing in calculation. If you don't look at all the options, you won't get the right move. So if you began with king f6, then you would be in trouble, because after king f5 here, white has this powerful move e4, king g4. And what happens is both the pawns rush towards queening and the queen at the same time. And this position is a draw. There's no way to exchange the queens or for black to win. So therefore, you realize that g5 has to be played here. And once again, now you have three moves to consider. One is to take the pawn. The other one is to push the pawn, and the last one is king g3. Now taking the pawn, of course, looks wrong, because after king g6, king g3, king g5, this is completely winning. I hope you figured that out. And so you have a choice between king to g3 and h5. I think king g3 is a very tricky move, and one which you should take good notice of, because after g into h4, king into h4, king f6 and king g4, this position is drawn. But you should begin with king to g6 and after king g4 take on h4, so that white is forced to take, and now you can play king f5, pushing the king inside, and after king g3 go king e4, king f2, and here comes an important moment. Black has to choose whether he will push this pawn or this pawn, and I think a general thumb of rule of thumb is that you push the pawn which is least flexible. So here this pawn can go to e6 or e5, it's a very flexible pawn, and so you keep that option alive and you push the a pawn, king e2. If you play a4, then I can now go king d3, king f3 and e5, completely winning the game. King e2, a4, white tries to stop, a3, and now e6. See, the option helps. Now you come here, outflank, and after king d3, play e5, and it's game over. When the king moves back, the pawn comes up, and e3 pawn is lost. So that brings us to another important realization, that king g3 loses the game. So h5 has to be once again considered, and after king g7, king g3, now comes the final trick. I hope you noticed it, not king h6, because after king g4, white is doing really well. A5, e4, a4, e5, and basically it's black who has to give up the move here, because it's mind squares, and you see the reserve tempi are, it's the same. White has one pawn on this which is flexible here like black, and one pawn on the third rank like black. So that's the reason why black has to wait here with king h7, an excellent move, because now when white would love to play king h3 or f3 and then, you know, keep his g4 square as an option when black comes on h6. So these two squares are sort of connected, they are the mind squares. M-I-N-E-D, mind squares. But white has to take, he has no way to keep in touch with the g4 square, and after king h6, game over. You know, the white has to push his pawns, say a4, a5, and this is winning, and well, whatever you push, e4, a5, basically black has been able to win. So that's the reason why rook g4 is the correct move. Now you understand how deep we are looking at, yeah, when you come to endgames. And that's why I simply love this book. It has 400 pages. It's the Dvoretsky's Endgame Manual. And it's just pure gold over here. All problems. In fact, I realized how good this book is when I spoke to Carsten Mueller, who is also considered as one of world's leading expert on the endgame. And he said, yes, I have written fundamental chess endings, but I would recommend Dvoretsky's Endgame Manual as one of the best endgame books. So, you know, if a guy who has written a book on the same subject says that the other book is good, then it must be. Here are the six books of Dvoretsky that I have brought here. I'm reading all of them. You know, I always keep getting these comments from all of you saying, why are you not playing? And I think the Dvoretsky's books have really ignited my love for chess preparation and practice again. I solved these positions in the morning and I wanted to share it with you. So which are these six books? The six books which we are talking about are these ones. Dvoretsky's Endgame Manual, Dvoretsky's Analytical Manual, Recognizing Your Opponent's Resources, Chess Lessons, Maneuvering, the Art of Peace Play, Tragicomedy in the Endgame. These are the six books. The entire bundle cost would if you add up all the prizes here, comes to 7,000. But if you buy them all together, you save 1,000 rupees and you get all the 6 books delivered for free at your home in India. Just very quickly, I would like to show you the contents of this book, Dvoretsky's Endgame Manual. You see, the pawn endgames are given a lot of importance, nearly 70 pages dedicated to it. And then as you move on, you have the knight versus pawns, knight endgames, bishop versus pawns, opposite color bishop endgame, bishops of same color, bishop versus knight. This is over here. And then as you move on, you have rook versus pawn. Now this is one of my favorite chapters, but the rook endgame is again a huge chapter with 80 pages dedicated to it. And finally, as we move towards the end, you have rook versus knight, rook versus bishop, queen endgames, queen versus rook, other material relations over here, general endgame ideas and solutions. So what you are looking at when you solve Dvoretsky's endgame manuals are, first of all, theoretical positions which you must know, and then very interesting studies, very interesting positions, analysis, which also you should be knowing. So all in all, it's a book which has to be read by all of you, and I recommend it highly. The links to how you can get these books are given in the description below. I hope you enjoyed both the endgames, and if I am practicing more with these books, I'm sure to post more positions for you. Until then, see you and goodbye.